In the book, The Great Pretenders, veteran political analyst Ibrahim Harvey delivers a stinging critique of the ANC. Harvey argues that a series of events, including HIV/AIDS denialism, the Marikana shootings, the Nkandla funding scandal, mass student protests, the Esidimini tragedy, systemic corruption and state capture are rooted in policy choices made by the ANC during negotiations and in power. Nastasia Arinsa spoke to the author Ibrahim Harvey for more.
Yeah, no, I've said it before, I think on radio, TV, when I was asked this question. Maggie Davey, one of the directors of Jacana, had suggested this title to Bridget Impey, the managing director there. And it took me for about a week or two because I was initially a bit uncomfortable, you know. And I checked with a number of people, Colin Bundy, the editor in London, and many people. And finally, I began to see the brilliant wisdom, in fact, of that title, given the nature of the book and how the ANC has broken so many promises. So I thought it's very appropriate and apt, you know, the title, and I made my peace with it. I was rather happy and regretted that I had initially been reluctant with the title, you know.
While we're on the topic of broken promises, let's break down this title, The Great Pretenders, because most people might associate it with Freddie Mercury. So yes. What exactly do we mean when we say The Great Pretenders? What has been the history of the ANC from, you know, the early 90s, probably the early 1912s or 21, if I'm not mistaken, right up until now?
You know, it's rather simple to answer your question about the title and contrast it with what has happened in post-apartheid South Africa. I mean, if you look at the guiding documents that the ANC embraced, the RDP adopted as its program for the 1994 elections, in 1956 it adopted the Freedom Charter. And if you're familiar with the demands in the Freedom Charter and that of the RDP and a whole range of rights of the RDP, and you see what's happening today in South Africa, and you go through the townships, black working townships in particular, it's a fundamental contrast and contradiction. You cannot believe it. You know, I study water and sanitation, both my higher degrees, so I know that area very well, and I'll tell you, go and walk in the black townships today. It's an unmitigated mess. I mean, sewerage running down the streets, children dying of in pit latrines, water, sanitation, schools without it. It's just an abysmal mess. And I'll tell you, during the darkest moment of apartheid, we were anti-apartheid activists. I was very much involved from 1972. The townships where the ANC support historically has lied has never been in as big a mess and social crisis as it is today. And you know, you don't even need to go and study it. You just keep abreast of the newspapers and you see it on your TV screens. It's just unbelievable what ANC rule has turned out to be. And hence my decision to write this book, you know. But we had begun to see already during the negotiations period in the 1990s what lied ahead. I wrote many pieces and I was part of groups, you know, looking at what was happening when Dallas released and so on. And we really predicted, but not to this extent, I must tell you. The most pessimistic analysis of ANC rule, I don't even think envisaged the depth of the decay, degeneration and betrayal as stark as you can see in South Africa today.
So last week we had the riots and the unrest, and I couldn't help but think of the various chapters in your book and also to think about the levels of poverty and inequality in South Africa. Do you think that this might be the opportune time to talk about reshaping the economic and social system within our country in order to, I don't know, benefit more people on the ground, more communities?
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's probably the most important and interesting question I've ever been asked in a range of interviews I've done on radio, TV, since the book was launched first week of May. That is it. That is it. You see, unless, and this is the problem now, and unfortunately the factionals' battle in the ANC is going to distract their attention from getting down to a vision and a program that can fundamentally change things around for who has suffered. The people who have benefited from BEE and affirmative action is this tiny black elite and the more numerous black middle class. The people who have suffered. In fact, those people made advances at the expense of the black working class majority in the townships. And you can even see the contrast. When look at how they live in formerly white suburbia, all the ANC top brass, and go and look at how their members and followers live in the townships. And you'll see there is it epitomized the betrayal in this country. But the ANC abandoned the RDP. It abandoned the Freedom Charter. And there you had very important demands and rights which could have shaped a very different future, you know, especially for the black working class majority. Unfortunately, you know, right now, while that is objectively required, the factionalist divide, the bitterness in the ANC, especially following Jacob Zuma's imprisonment, is so bad that I doubted that they would be able to fasten around attend to this huge problem. And your question is so correct, you know. But let me tell you where the ANC needs to begin to change things for the better. It is with basic services. And unfortunately, it is at that level where you see the biggest mess in the townships. You know, people do not live on what is purportedly the best, greatest constitution in the world, which they say the South African constitution is. They need water, sanitation, adequate food, shelter, you know, homes, health services, etc. And that is where the biggest mess and crisis exists in the townships. That's why I'm saying you need a sea change in attitude from the ANC leadership and in its policies. Today's crisis has to do with not just corruption in the ANC. No, it's got to do with the neoliberal policies the ANC implemented from the word go in 1994. 2 months after the ANC took office, go and look at the Water Services Act. It began to commercialize, corporatize, and commodify water. And with that is linked sanitation. And thereafter, you can see the installation and imposition of prepaid water meters, electricity meters. There are townships in winter. They're without water and electricity and sanitation because they're on prepaid meters. You know, and when they have a tiny lifeline, so-called, cynically, when it's exhausted and they can't pay for water and electricity, they go without water and electricity. It's a silent, terrible thing that hardly people speak about. I'm talking about the homes that have prepaid water and electricity meters.
Yeah.
And the allowance is exhausted. They go without water. So that is where the ANC has to make a fundamental change, is with basic services in the townships. From June 2004, there's been an unstoppable avalanche of townships. We are the protest capital of the world. And on the other side of that causal divide, we are the most unequal society in the world. And there you have two sides of the same coin. ANC needs to go back to the masses.
Yeah.
As Motlanthe said, when I interviewed him when he was president, after his 100 days in office for the Mail and Guardian, he said, Ibrahim, the only solution for the ANC is to go back to the masses.
Right.
And it got further away, went further away from the masses after that interview with him, the Mail and Guardian.
Ibrahim, for the interest of time, and there were so many things that I wanted to talk to you about, race and racialism and various other definitions. Yeah. But what do you hope that people get out of this book once they get their hands on it?
Well, I think the most important thing to get out of it, which is very clear throughout the book, we cannot continue on the same basis. The ANC has to make a fundamental policy change. It has to change its policies towards a more... This thing about it being pro-working class is an absolute unmitigated lie.
Yeah.
This thing that they have pro-poor policies of the ANC is a lie. It's a shameless lie, you know? And that is what is needed. Readers, I hope, wake up to the realization after reading this book that there's no future for this country. Let me tell you, unless the interests and needs of the black working class majority will be marginalized by this transition and transformation so-called in South Africa after 1994. It is time, if there's one class of people who requires and needs a fundamental change, you know, is the black working class majority. And you have to start with basic services in the townships, you know. That is what people live by, not sweet promises. How many promises has the ANC broken? Electoral promises.
Yeah.
They can use that a better life for all. You know, it was their rallying slogan with elections. They don't even use it anymore because I think they've even come to realize what a cynical lie it is. Because after elections, you know, people continue their lives in the same conditions and often worse they face.